Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Lovely to see you. Welcome to church today. If you're visiting with us, a special word of welcome to you. If you're joining us online, welcome to you as well. It's a communion Sunday here in Cairncastle today, and it would be really lovely if we could shake hands with each other, but we're still being careful, okay? Let's instead just speak to each other. So can I suggest that perhaps, maybe you've already been chatting, that's fine, but would you make a point of turning to those that you can see and say to them, grace and peace. It's a very New Testament, isn't it? Grace and peace. Grace and peace. Grace and peace. Grace and peace. So we will be observing the sacrament of communion in the latter part of this service. Next Sunday, the service will begin with an act of remembrance. And there's also Sunday school, a creche, next Sunday as well. So pass the word round, just in case any of the boys and girls or mums and dads might have missed the date. Next Sunday, Sunday school and creche again. Let's worship God together. We're going to read some words from Psalm 116. And we'll do our usual, I'll do the ones in white. So I'll do verse 12 and we'll do verse 13 together and so on. So in this way we declare together God's truth from his word. What shall I return to the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, Jerusalem, praise the Lord. Amen. May God bless his word to us together here today. We're going to stand and sing the lovely modern hymn, As We Are Gathered. Jesus is here. Let's pray. Almighty God, gracious Father in heaven, we believe your word to be true, so we believe by definition that you are present, that Jesus is among his people by the Holy Spirit, wherever we gather, all over the face of the earth today. And so we are honored that you would include Cairncastle among the places that you will visit and make your presence known just now. Lord Jesus, we pray that in this service we might be enabled to perhaps set aside some of the things that have been filling our attention and really focus on you. And somehow will you help us to see you and to know, to really know that you are present and that you're here for us. And that the words that each of us need to hear, you wish to speak. So will you give us humble and listening hearts to really sense your being with us and a willingness to follow the direction that you will give. So, Lord, we offer up our praise and our thanks to you. What can we give in return for all your kindness and grace over years to us? We will take up the cup of thanksgiving. We will call on the name of the Lord. We will uplift the name of Jesus here in Cairncastle today. We want to honor you, Lord, our Master. We pray that you would be pleased with our praise and our prayers. We pray, O Lord, that you would look upon us in our need, for we need you. We need your help. So please look with compassion on this little crowd today, as you looked on the crowds in Galilee who were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Lord, will you come and be our shepherd just now and help us to know it deep inside and to love you in return with all our hearts and serve you in every way that we can. And I speak to us and teach us and instruct us with the truth of your word, please, for your name's sake. And we pray together, saying the words that Jesus himself taught his disciples. We say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our readings today are in the book of Genesis. The first is in Genesis chapter 28, and I'm going to read from verse 10. Let me just fill in the background a little bit. We were thinking about Abraham last week, Abraham and Sarah, who eventually, after a long time of waiting, gave birth to Isaac. And Isaac, he became the father of twin boys, Jacob and Esau. And there was really no love lost between these two brothers. They were completely different, chalk and cheese from day one. And, well, Jacob cheated his brother and deceived his own father in a very cruel, callous, horrible way. Esau found out and, of course, was not pleased and threatened to murder his brother. And so Jacob has had to go on the run. And this is Jacob on the run, having left his home and being out in the open country. Genesis 28, verse 10. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran, far in the north. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord. And he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go. And I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. He was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Early the next morning, Jacob took the stone he had placed under his head and set it up as a pillar and poured oil on top of it. He called that place Bethel, in Hebrew, Beth El, the house of God, though the city used to be called Luz. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I'm taking and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear so that I can return safely to my father's house, then the Lord will be my God, and this stone that I have set up as a pillar will be God's house, and of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth. Amen. May God bless his word to us here just now. Having read that, it might make a little bit more sense of our next hymn, which is well known, but this is where it's taken from in the Bible. O God of Bethel, by whose hand thy people still are fed. We stand to sing. you might this afternoon like to read the chapters in between the next bit of the story and some of the experiences that Jacob had in Haran, living among relatives there. He finds a wife and he begins his family and so on. And then in chapter 32 of Genesis, he is instructed by the Lord, the God of Abraham and Isaac, and now the God of Jacob, that it's time to come home. And so he gathers up all his belongings and his large family and so on, and he starts to head back. But naturally he is very apprehensive, because who's he going to meet when he gets back home? He's going to have to face his brother, the brother whom he cheated from the birthright and the blessing all those years before. So he has come, he's made as good preparation as he can, he has sent gifts and messages to Esau that he's coming and wants to meet him. Genesis 32 and verse 22 describes Jacob having another, really rather peculiar encounter with the Lord his God. Genesis 32 and verse 22. That night Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maidservants, and his 11 sons, and crossed the ford of the river Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. And so Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daylight, daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men, and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his Amen. May God bless his word to us in Cairncastle today. There is one thing you could say about the Bible, and it is this. It is honest about its characters. It portrays them as they are, warts and all. As we read the account of Jacob and his really quite dysfunctional family, we may feel that these are not really very nice people. They certainly don't always act with integrity. They do some atrocious things on each other. If this were fiction, the heroes would be made a little more attractive. But this is the Word of God. And so the characters are uncomfortably real. Just like us. Most of the people we read of in these chapters of Genesis, both men and women, seem very self-interested, self-motivated. They seem to be looking out for themselves and theirs, and really quite prepared to cheat and take from others. Jacob cheats his brother Esau, encouraged by his mother, deceives his father Isaac. As a result, Jacob has to flee his family home in the land of promise and live in exile for some 20 years. The deception continues there in Haran as Jacob is tricked by his uncle and later tricks him back. And the men in this account, the men, follow the practice of their day and have more than one wife. So Jacob's 12 sons, the heads of the 12 tribes of Israel, are actually born to four different mothers. which leads to all kinds of jealous rivalry. And that's going to come out in the next week as we start to think about Joseph. This is not pleasant reading. Some of it is really quite disturbing. You would be inclined to close it and put it down, except for one thing. God promised to bless Abraham's family, and God keeps his word. Even if some of us are dishonorable in the short term, even if some of us struggle against his leading, God is faithful. And his grace is the light which shines through these tangled human stories. If there's hope for Jacob and his family, then there's hope for us all. Let me point out three things from these accounts that encourage us to trust the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The God who would in time extend his grace to the whole world through the offspring of Jacob, the Lord Jesus. First of all, let's realize God is closer than we might think. Jacob is on the run for his life in chapter 28. Nothing but the bare earth for his bed and a stone for his pillow. When he is given a vision of a stairway between earth and heaven, with a constant flow of God's angels up and down. Usually unseen, these heavenly messengers bring protection and direction from God to those who trust him. Jacob is given a glimpse of his father's God, and God reaffirms the covenant promises he made to Abraham. This territory will one day belong to Jacob's descendants. Meanwhile, God will be with him and watch over him on his journey, and in time, God will bring him home. Well, what a comforting message to someone whose life was in an absolute mess. What comfort to someone who'd had to leave his home and family behind. What comfort to someone who is facing an uncertain future alone. Now, people don't normally see God, so we might be inclined to think of him as far away in heaven, if he exists at all. He'd probably be too busy to listen or help poor failures like us anyway. But no. God is actually much nearer than we think. And notice again how God takes the initiative to reach out to this rather sorry individual. There's no record of Jacob seeking God. God comes looking for him. And that brings us to the second thing. Not only is God closer and more real than we might have thought, he seems determined to bless us. Now, this is amazing grace. When we read some of the other material here in Genesis, we might think Jacob deserved his lonely exile. Every bit of it. He'd been such a deceiver, such a mean, really quite a horrible person to his own family. He deserved to be sent packing. But God demonstrates great goodness and mercy and love in providing for him and his growing family. Well, we've been thinking from Genesis on some very serious things in recent weeks. And we've had to consider how sinful human beings may deserve to be flooded or showered with the fire of righteous judgment, as we see happening elsewhere in the book of Genesis. But we're encouraged to also note this. In the same first book of the Bible, God chooses, despite all our human failure, God chooses to show grace and kindness And he seeks to win our hearts, that we would turn from wickedness and consciously seek to know and follow him and enjoy his blessing. Already in this first book of the Old Testament, we're being prepared for the gospel, good news of the New Testament, the message of Jesus, the message declared by the apostles, that God still loves this world of sinners so much. He refuses to abandon us to the judgment that we earn with our sin, but instead has reached out to us with the gift of his Son, Jesus. Jesus comes, deals with our guilt, and invites us to receive and know his love forever. I think it's fair to say, as we read on, that Jacob did not become a model character overnight. At times he seemed to be quite a slow learner. But this encounter, the first one, where he sees the stairway between earth and heaven, this encounter started Jacob on the path of learning to trust and obey God. It was a start, a vital start. At this point, let me pause and give out an invitation to members of Cairncastle. Have you started for real with God? Because it seems that a lot of people believe in God, but do so like from a distance. And you know a bit about Christianity and a little bit about the Bible and so on, but have you ever actually started firmly, clearly, and said, right, I'm in. I have a lot to learn, but I'm following Jesus. I'm going to put my trust in him. Have you ever done that? Or if you haven't, if you're still a little bit uncertain or maybe on the fence, do you know what? I'd love to chat with you. If it would help you, speak to me afterwards. Or give me a wee call and we'll make a time at your convenience so we can talk about these things. I'd love nothing better. So there you go. Pass that on. Anybody wants to know about following Jesus, wants to talk to someone about it, talk to me. You're welcome. But there's a third thing that we need to note from this story about Jacob. God is closer than we think, yep. He seems determined to bless us, amazingly. The third thing I would suggest that we note is how God's faithfulness over time gives us a home and a heritage. It may take a lifetime. Took 20 years at least for Jacob. We may at times be lacking in faith or courage. We may make many mistakes. But God is patient, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance and salvation and life. And so, as we read on in chapter 32, 33, we find after some time, Jacob returns to Canaan. By now he's a wealthy man. He's got a large family. He is reconciled to his brother Esau. And when their father Isaac passes away, the two brothers bury him together. So there is honor before the end of this story. But we read the bit of Jacob wrestling the angel. As he prepares to face the brother he wronged years before, Jacob has a strange spiritual encounter in which he wrestles a man all night, but the text would suggest this was no ordinary man. This was a messenger from God. And this wrestling match seems to be a picture of Jacob's life because he's been a struggler the whole way up to now. He has struggled to get along with other people, members of his own family, and he has struggled to trust and obey God. But here's the thing. By this stage, Jacob knows better than to let go. And so he clings on to this mysterious opponent, this peculiar wrestling that he's engaged in. No way he's going to let go. He's seeking an assurance of God's blessing. I won't let go, not until I know I have your blessing. And the sun rises on a Jacob who is humbled, but wiser and better for this knowledge of God's grace. Jacob, at last, is ready to come home. Now, in Christ, God has reached out, not just to one person or family or even nation, but to people of every nation in every corner of the globe. And God promises in Christ a heavenly home and an inheritance in the coming resurrection age when all will be made new. All God's people from every tribe and tongue will sit together in peace and in fellowship at his table. So, Cairncastle, let's be determined today, as individuals and as a fellowship together, let's be determined. We're not going to be slow learners. We are going to be eager, willing students. Let's commit to learn, trust, and obedience. Let's show our thanks for God's grace in acts of humility and generosity and love. Love for him shown in our love for one another. And to God be the glory. Amen. Let's pray. Almighty God, Father in heaven, some things in your word puzzle us, and at times we're not quite sure how to respond or how to pray. But we're thankful, we think, for this story of Jacob, this rather twisty, sneaky character who really did some quite shameful things, and yet received your grace, and over time was changed. So, that encourages us. There's hope for Jacob, hope for people like Jacob, hope for all people because of Jesus. So as we've already prayed, show us Jesus. At the end of this Old Testament story, confront us with Jesus who came into this world, your gift, and reaches out arms of love to people like us, who so desperately need your grace, your forgiveness, your help. Help us to see Jesus, and we'll be satisfied. It's in his name we pray. Amen. As we come to the communion part of our service, we sing a lovely hymn. We practiced this on Wednesday night. Someone was singing it for the first time. It may be new to you, or you may have heard Kristen Getty or Stuart Townend sing this. It's a beautiful song. May the peace of God, our heavenly Father. Thank you. because we're going to continue to declare our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. We are going to depart in the sacrament of communion, this Christian sacrament. Let's declare what Christians believe. And we say this aloud together. I believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Let's hear God's word as it's written in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 23. For I received from the Lord the teaching that I passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took a piece of bread, gave thanks to God, broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in memory of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is God's new covenant, sealed with my blood. Whenever you drink it, do so in memory of me." This means that every time you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. May God bless his word to us here today. Over the last number of Wednesday evenings, we've been thinking about communion, and we've been thinking of it as looking in different directions. Do you want to understand what this table is all about? Well, think of it like this. One thing we do, we look back. We look back in history, and what do we look towards? We look to the cross. We look to the once-for-all sacrifice of Jesus on our behalf on Golgotha. He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So we look back with gratitude for his sacrifice on our behalf. But that's not all. We also look up. We look up, as it were, to heaven, to our risen Lord, who is sitting on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. We look to him who is living and who loves us and who is concerned about our present need. And we say, "Jesus, will you help us? We're here in obedience to your word. Will you nourish us? Will you feed our hearts and our souls and help us to reflect something of you, your goodness and your glory and your love?" Even that's not all. We also look inside. In this same passage, Paul encourages his readers to take a careful look at themselves as they come to communion. Take a careful look at your own life. Is it everything it should be? Is your relationship with God everything it should be? Here's an opportunity to repent, if that's necessary. Some direction you've been going which is not honoring to God, the opportunity to come back into life and to draw nearer to God again in Christ. We also look around. We look at each other and we bless each other in the loving fellowship of the family of God. And we also look forward. We look forward to the day when Jesus will come again and gather all his people and bring us to our heavenly inheritance. All of that is communicated in this simple thing that Jesus did on the Passover supper, when he took bread. Something we have in every nation on earth. Bread, food. He broke it. He said, "This is my body, which is for you. do this in memory of me. And then he took what they were drinking. He took the cup and he said, this is the new covenant, the new way of going, the new arrangement with God, the way of God's grace in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in memory of me. So let us do as Jesus did that night of the Passover supper. And let us, first of all, bow our heads and give thanks for the table that is prepared for us. Let's pray. Almighty God, our Father in heaven, we thank you that you so loved the world, you gave your only Son. Whosoever trusts in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. We thank you, God, for this communion table prepared for us. We thank you for this bread and this wine. We thank you for this opportunity to share together in faith the supper of our Lord Jesus. Dear Lord and Master, we have come in obedience to your word to take this bread, this wine, and to think on you, to look back to Calvary, to look up to heaven, to look inside and seek the cleansing of our hearts and souls, to look around in love at one another in fellowship, and to look forward with joy to the promised time when sin and sorrow shall be no more and you shall make all things new. Thank you for this table, this bread, this wine, which now for us become precious signs and symbols of you, our Lord and Savior and Master. Help us now to take part in this sacrament in humility and in faith, and may we receive from you nourishment for our very souls, that we might be better Christians, better people in every way, and that we might glorify you in all of our living. Hear our prayer, which we offer to God our Father, in Jesus' name, with the help of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, you're perhaps aware that because of the COVID, we still are not distributing the bread literally from the table to the pews. So in front of you, you should have a little container like this. And if you open that now, you'll find that inside is a little piece of bread and a little cup to drink as well. And so at this point, we take the bread together. Jesus said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup. He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in memory of me. The Lord's death until he comes. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, may we rise from this simple act of obedience, cleansed by your blood, assured of your love, empowered by your Spirit. May we love you and serve you better than ever for your glory, as we seek to proclaim your name, your atoning death, your glorious resurrection, until you come. Amen. Our closing praise, when I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count loss and pour contempt on all my pride.
Fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.